Next, we'll talk about designing object-oriented programs, some of the choices you'll encounter, and some guidance for how to come to a useful solution. Okay, here's the checking account class that we just defined. And let me just reiterate why we did certain things that we did. So first of all, it's important to continue following the guidelines that you saw earlier in the course. Don't repeat yourself. Use existing implementations whenever you can, and try to avoid copying and pasting code. Second, attributes that have been overridden should still be accessible via class objects. What am I talking about? Well, to override an attribute means that in the subclass, you're giving an attribute the same name as exists in the base class. So here we see the checking account class has withdraw, which also exists in the count class. But even though we've overridden that name, meaning the checking accounts will call this withdraw instead of the original withdraw, we can still access them and use them using the class object. So here's the account class, and account.withdraw will give us the original withdraw method, as opposed to this new one for checking accounts. So we can still defer to the old logic, and we just make this small change of using a withdraw fee. You can also look up attributes on instances whenever possible, and this is a good idea. So what am I talking about there? Well, when we compute the total amount that we're going to withdraw, amount plus self withdraw fee, we had several options here. We could just write amount plus one, hard coding with the withdraw fee, but then we could never change it. We could also write amount plus checking account dot withdraw fee, which would get this one, this attribute here, but it wouldn't allow for the fact that some checking accounts might have a special withdraw fee. So the best way to do this is to look up withdraw fee on the instance itself, which means that if that instance has a particular withdraw fee, we'll use it. If not, we'll use the one from the account. Okay, so here we have attribute lookup on a base class, and here we have looking up an instance attribute, and that's preferred to looking up checking account.withdraw fee, because it allows for specialized accounts, either through further subclasses or by giving instance attributes to particular accounts. The other thing you need to think about when designing an object-oriented programming is when to use inheritance versus when to use composition. What's composition? Well, that's when one object has another object as an attribute, and that's a very common pattern as well. So object-oriented programming shines when we follow the metaphor. That is, we treat objects like real things in the world. This helps us think about them clearly. So inheritance is best to represent is a relationships, meaning a checking account is a type of account. So checking out is a specific type of account, so checking account naturally inherits from account, and thereby has all of the attributes of that account. Composition, when one object has another one as an attribute, is best for representing has a relationships. So for example, a bank has a collection of bank accounts that it manages. So in that case, a bank has a list of accounts as an attribute, but a bank won't inherit from account, and an account won't inherit from a bank. They're related in that one has the other as an attribute, but they're not related according to inheritance. So let's design a bank real quick. A bank won't inherit from account because a bank has accounts. And what will it look like to use a bank? Well, we'll create a bank. So now we have a new bank. And bank is going to do things like create accounts for us. So if I go to the bank, then I might open account, give them my personal identifying information. Hi, I'm John. Here's $10. Please open an account for me. And the bank will remember that it's opened that account and it will return it. And my good friend Jack might go to the bank and open an account as well. and Jack only has $5 with him, and the bank manager says, oh, that's fine, but you're going to have to open a checking account. So John has just a normal account, which means John's interest rate is should be 0.02, whereas Jack's interest rate with his checking account will be 0.01. Okay, so what do banks do? Well, banks pay interest on the money that you keep with them. So let's say we just paid that interest, and now we can check and see what John's balance is, and balance has the $10 that he had before and an extra 20 cents because he had 2% interest on his $10. Okay, so now we have an interesting problem on our hands. How do we implement the bank? Well, let's look for some clues about how to implement the bank by this example that we've drawn so far, and we'll write the implementation. So bank is constructed with no arguments. What's going to happen when we open a bank? We're going to have to remember what accounts are held by that bank. When I go to a bank and I open an account, that's a method where self is bound to the bank. And then we also see that we have a holder, an amount, and some kind of account that we open, which is optional. So let's say by default we open a regular account. What happens when we open an account? Well, we have to create that account. How do we do that? Well, we'll call kind, which is either account or checking account, pass in the holder, because that's how bank accounts work. We'll deposit into that new account the amount that was given to us. Next, we have to remember that this is one of our accounts, as opposed to an account in another bank. So we're going to add this account to our list of accounts, and then we can return it. Okay, what's the last piece of the implementation? We have to be able to pay interest. Paying interest takes no arguments beyond the bank itself. So how do we pay interest? Well, we have to go through every account that we have. So we'll call it A. And how do I get all of the accounts that I have? Well, that's called self.accounts. And for each one, I'll deposit some extra money in it, which depends on its current balance and the interest rate for that account. Let's see if all of our tests pass, and they do. So we've implemented the bank, not using inheritance. So are we finished? Well, not quite yet. We need to provide some protection for our bank because we don't want our bank to get into trouble if it ends up paying out too much interest. So we should probably write a function about whether it's too big to fail. And when would that be true? Well, probably whenever we have at least two accounts. So is this bank too big to fail? Certainly is. I mean, it holds both John and Jack's money. Test pass.